Today on Real Life, a Christian conversion story making its way to the big screen. Plus, is prayer more powerful when you're in a group? Rabbi Daniel and Susan Lapin share their wisdom on that. And the man refusing to let his disability stop him from serving Christ. All that and more right now on Real Life.
This is real life. God loves you. Jesus died for you. The Holy Spirit, He empowers you. And the Bible is your and my guide to abundant life. I'm your host, Don Black, with my beautiful wife and co-host, Terry.
Co-host for life. Hello. Welcome. Buenos, no, whatever.
What was that?
Hola. I was trying to be Spanish.
She's speaking in tongues, folks. We need an interpretation. Will somebody call in with the interpretation, please?
Well, hello.
You know, I'm a history fan.
Yes, you are.
I've drugged you through the history troughs of many states.
He didn't actually drag me. I went willingly. They're going to think that you actually are pulling me, but
I have taken her all over the country and parts of the world, looking at where things happened. Because I like to go where history occurred. There's something about history. The reason I like history is because it's not so much the events that happen, it's the people in the events.
Oh, right. And I think sometimes it's great. History, there's lessons to be learned. And I don't know about you, there's a lot of ways that we can learn in life. And for me, one of the ways I like to learn is by history of other people, those that have gone before me, and I observe and I learn from that. And there's another way is you just go through the trial and the fire yourself. So isn't history a great way to learn?
Unfortunately, for most of us, we have to learn, make our own history. The term history tells you what it is. Mm-hmm. You know, if you spell history, it's his story. So history is just a reference to what God has done behind us. Yeah. Prophecy is His word about what's going to happen before us. Right. See, the Lord doesn't want us ever to be in the dark.
No, what? He doesn't?
No. It's not God's will that we would stumble around. His word's a light. Light. Mm-hmm. He's light. We're light. Light illuminates. Mm-hmm. Light chases the darkness away. So God's a God of light, not a God of darkness.
That's
not
true.
God of darkness. So history is shining the light backwards at God's story in the past. That's why the Bible is full of stories of what God has done. And then prophecy is God shining His light forward on what He's going to do. And here's what's really cool about it. Prophecy always aligns to history.
It always does. And always. If it doesn't, what does that mean?
If it doesn't align, then it's outside the Word of God. See, every prophetic message has to line up with the Word of God. God's not going to tell you anything outside of His will. And how do you know God's will? We've heard this 1,000 times. God's will is His Word.
And you got it.
This is God's will for you. Mm-hmm. If you're at home and you're going, boy, I want to know God's will for my life, you know where you're going to find it? In His Word.
Wasn't there some piece of history that told us that the average person might read, 3 minutes a day of the Bible? It's not very much at all.
That's more social science. Because we have an enemy who wants to keep us in the shadows.
That's right. And I guess my point is that we just need to take time to read God's Word. You know, that's just something you can start your day off or end your day, but it's really important to read God's Word. And you know what it does? It doesn't return void. It just sort of takes root and it flourishes and it grows and it changes and it renews. That's really exciting to be part of that.
Well, in today's program, we have a historian who's an author that we're going to hear a story. And I love the study of World War II. World War II is one of my favorite times. So if you have an interest in World War II, but not the war, you say, well, that's kind of masochistic. You want to study war, you enjoy war. It's not that. It's His story.
Right. You're saying the people that are part of the World War.
God used people. Now, it's a conflict between good and evil.
Right.
That's what history is. So you don't want to go anywhere. Stay with us through this whole program because we're going to be looking at God in the now by looking back at what He did in the past. And the Bible says, Revelation says this, they overcame the devil, the enemy, with the blood of the Lamb. And
the word
of
their
testimony. The word of their testimony is just a fancy word of saying history. Yeah. It's just what it is. The word of their testimony is history. We go out and look at the news. Sydney goes, finds us the good news. Let's see what she's found.
I'm Sydney Grant for God in the Headlines. Here's your top story. Fox is developing a modern-day Bible drama. The network is currently working on a series called The Scroll. Queen Latifah and Holly Carter of Relevant Entertainment are the executive producers of the project. Deadline reports The Scroll will reimagine some of the Bible's most popular stories in a present-day setting. The stories will be told through a group of friends and colleagues. 20th Century Fox TV set up the project. The Scroll is being targeted for the next development season.
See more and more television programs and movies that have a spiritual message.
Oh, yeah. So it's called The Scroll. Is that what's coming up?
I don't know. Let's get Sydney over here. Sydney, come over and tell us. We need information. Help us understand.
I know. Look. Scoop Sydney. There we go. We got her name. Scoop Sydney. I know. But she gets all the scoop. Yeah. Tell us.
So what's that about?
So it's called The Scroll, and I guess Fox is in development with it. So it's going to have like real, it's like modern day Bible stories like told. So it's kind of powerful.
Oh, sort of like a parable, modern day parables in a way.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a great way to learn.
Well, let's be praying for them that they won't take the message away. Mm-hmm. See, one of the things we see Hollywood sometimes do is they kind of want to tap into the story, but they take the message away. Like the movie about Noah, you know, the Noah movie.
Oh,
what a strange thing that was. Did you guys see the Noah movie?
Yeah, I did. I thought it was not what I read in the Bible at all, a lot of it.
Well, that's taking the message away. You know, you kind of carry along on the storyline, but you don't tell really the story of what really Noah was. So let's pray that they'll stay true to the gospel at the levels they can. I mean, you don't expect them to have an altar call, but they'd have some truth of Jesus in them.
Well, I know that there are some new movies coming out too right now, aren't there? Like there's a movie, The Shack. I haven't seen that,
but I've heard it's
an excellent movie. And you know, we've had some movies that really have portrayed Christianity in a positive light. I think, you know,
there was movies that did really well, like Hacksaw Ridge, which portrayed a Christian story of a man. Did you see that film?
I didn't get a chance to see it, but I heard it's like phenomenal.
I saw it in the hallway. I got too scared, and so I left, and I just stayed out in the hallway. I got to hear it all. I didn't actually see it all, so I'm a wimp when it comes to certain movies. I can't stand a lot of that.
Terry watches movies in an unusual way. First of all, she doesn't really watch movies. We have a TV that we watch movies on, and so some of our family will go in and we'll watch it and, you know, enjoy the entire movie. Mm-hmm. Terry doesn't do that. She kind of walks around, especially if it's rated PG or more. Like if it has any kind of violence in it or anything.
I'll go up the stairs. I'll stand on the steps.
Yeah, that's what she watches it from the stairs. And
like
peeks around the corner and says,
What is that?
And then here's the funny thing about how we watch movies in our family. She'll come in about an hour into the film and go, well, why'd they do that?
I do that. And then I always want to know how the movie ended. So I make Don, they won't do that anymore. They'll used to tell me things that happen in the movie and how it goes. And then they'll go, nope, not anymore. You got to watch the movie. And so I'm like, oh my gosh, I got to go through that scary part. I can't do it. So, you know what I do? I go online and I read all the synopsis. So,
this is coming from the same person who likes to read the last chapter of the book.
I do. I know.
Really?
I know. Isn't that terrible? It's not terrible.
It's just how I am.
I met somebody else that does it. I read the beginning, but I always read the end first, so I know how it'll end. Then I go back through the book. Very peculiar, isn't it?
I want to try that to read the end.
You would?
Yeah, I would do it just for you. Yeah,
I'm so glad to hear that.
Let me recommend not doing that, Sydney. let the storyteller tell the story the way that they wanted to tell the story.
I did see a great movie. I saw Hidden Figures. That was such a good movie.
It was really, really good. I love like stories like that.
I know.
Hear history and coming to life. Yeah,
it was. I had no idea these women made such an impact in NASA. Oh my goodness.
There's a lot of those untold stories. And in just a few minutes, we're going to talk to an author who's telling an untold story in history. And as soon as you know about what the storyline is, you're going to go, oh, wow. Because the event is world-shaking, mm-hmm. but the stories of the people in the event are mysteries.
Oh, I like mysteries.
Yeah, it's a mystery, so you don't want to go away. You want to stay with us. Stay with us as you get the story kind of unravels. That's what I love about parables. I love about parables. I like the storytelling that Jesus, that he used in parables, in getting people engaged mm-hmm. so that they would listen and connect. And then as they connected, then the truth gets woven into their lives through the Holy Spirit. That's really the bottom line on all storytelling. And it's really a kind of a connection between the imagination and reality. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. 'Cause stories use imagination. There's nothing wrong with imagination. Mm-hmm. You ought to exercise your imagination so that you can let the Spirit of God inspire you in your imagination. The Scripture's full of references to using our imaginations mm-hmm. and taking every thought captive and using what God's given us too. And even in prayer, even in the process of prayer, I grew up praying the Our Father, you know, that's right. how I grew up praying. And then as I've grown, I've known that Our Father is still one of my prayers. I still pray the Our Father prayer. But then as I pray more and more, I pray in the Spirit. I pray in what would be a just conversation style with God. Now, here's the question. Does group prayer, when you get together with people and pray together, is it different or more powerful than praying alone? Mm-hmm. Rabbi Daniel and Susan Lapin take on this question and ask the rabbi. Let's see what they say.
Hi, I'm Susan Lapin. Welcome to Ask the Rabbi with me and my husband, Rabbi Daniel Lapin. Let's jump right into a question that came to our website. What does the Bible say about group prayer? Is it more powerful than individual prayer? This was a question from Kenda, and I'm afraid it does get us a little bit on something personal because I know there is little you like as much as being on the bow of the boat when we're alone as a family and surrounded by gorgeous mountains and snow-capped mountains and beautiful water and praying.
Yeah, Susan's right. This is a tough one for me. It really is because I have to kind of say, do as I say, not as I do. Well, actually, most of the year I do pray in a synagogue in company, but some of my most meaningful moments with God do occur when we're on our boat off the coast of British Columbia during the summer, just looking at fjords and islands and mountains. So, but that all having been said, there really is a difference. And let me explain what this is. You know, nuclear power has the capability to save mankind from drudgery. Ultimately, at some point, when people genuinely do want to move to a form of clean electricity, in all probability, it will be nuclear-generated electricity, in spite of the various challenges and problems. When I listen to the way people speak about nuclear power, it reads exactly the same as people used to speak about coal power in the 18th and 19th centuries. So new technologies take a while to get in, but here's the point. How's nuclear power generated? What you have is what's called a critical mass in a reactor. You bring together a certain amount of uranium, and when that critical mass is achieved, a chain reaction begins, and when you need to turn it off or slow it down, you reduce the amount of the critical mass and it stops working. In other words, a crowd, a lot of it. There is such a thing as a critical mass in prayer as well. And that is exactly the idea. There's a certain amount that a piece of uranium by itself can do, but it's not a whole lot. If you really want to drive a submarine around the world on a thimble full of uranium, it's got to be in a critical mass, in a crowd. Worship has more power when we worship together with a group of people. There's a verse in Scripture which says, by the multitudes of the people will God be praised. And that's exactly what we're talking about. So yes, there are times I will confess, there are times where I prefer I just need to pray by myself. There are times I love praying by myself, but I do know that overall, in general, there is an enormous advantage to be had.
At the end of the book of Esther, it says that Mordechai gathered all the people together to pray. And it's not that, obviously God listens to an individual prayer, but God likes us having a relationship with him and with everybody else, with other people. And so he does listen more carefully and he listens more quickly when prayer is coming, when you have made yourself as one with a group of people all praying for the same thing together. That has a power.
So we are big enthusiasts of people finding a church family, finding a synagogue family, finding somewhere where you can be part of the group, allying yourself with the group, supporting the group, helping the group. And just through that process, the power of prayer does get multiplied. It's achieving what we call a critical mass. Let us know how it goes. Give it a try. Spend a little time praying with a crowd. I think you'll feel the difference. And I guess that's as far as we go today, but we hope you'll be together with us on the next Ask the Rabbi segment. And until then, we pray for you to have a week of good health and prosperity. Everything else, well, that's up to you.
So, Terry, what do you think? Praying by yourself, is it more powerful, or praying in a group, is it more powerful?
You know what? I don't have a straight answer. I mean, I see what he's saying is like, by yourself, you need that prayer. But I guess the question is powerful, you know, right? The question is, you're
effective.
More powerful. Effective. So I guess the righteous people coming together, that would be more effective. So being together, right, as a group would have more power, be more effective than being by yourself.
Yeah,
right?
It could be. It depends on whether the prayer is in unity or not, whether they're united hearts. The Bible says in James, a fervent prayer of a righteous man or woman avails much.
So if you have many, that would really avail
says
much.
That's in singular, of a righteous man avails much. So, so in an individual case, there's a lot of power and effectiveness in fervent prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what would be the advantage of bringing people together that are fervent? You know, where you put those righteous prayers together.
Right.
Where then the Bible says, whenever two or more of you are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of
right.
you.
Right, that's right.
So isn't God in our midst when we're by ourselves? What's the difference between me being in a prayer closet, which the Bible talks about, go to your prayer closet and pray. Is he not with you there in the prayer closet?
Yeah, I believe that he's in there. I guess I just felt like the question was, is it more powerful in a group or by yourself?
And that's where
the
answer is.
That's what the question is.
The when we're by ourselves in prayer, there's a personal power inside of us. Mm-hmm. It's me and the Lord, and we're in this communion, this relationship. When we bring people together, then there's a corporate power in prayer. Mm-hmm. Now, that doesn't mean you have to be necessarily in a church. It can be your family.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it can be your friends. You can do it. I believe we're just launching the Pittsburgh prayer team on Facebook. I think you can have fervent, righteous prayer in a virtual reality in the Pittsburgh prayer team. Go find it on Facebook, Pittsburgh prayer team, and join in corporately like that, because in corporate prayer, I feel like that's more, Terry, a prayer of engagement,
mm-hmm.
where we're together, we're doing either battle in our area for somebody or for something. It's praying in engagement prayer, whereas in personal prayer, it's me being more like Jesus.
Okay.
My transformation of me on a personal level. It happens in both environments. So prayer's great in both.
Right. So it's not either or. It's important to have both in our lives.
Yeah.
And if, you know, we have our prayer partner standing by at 1-888-665-4483 to pray with you. If you have as a group, we can pray together for your particular needs, because as Don shared, when two or more are gathered together in our midst, that the Lord is present. That's a corporate prayer, corporate power of the Holy Spirit coming together in unity to pray for your need. So we would like for you, and we encourage you to pray.
Maybe a good analogy is, you know, Jesus referred to as the body, you know, this body, and every joint, Paul says, every joint supplies that which it's supposed to supply. Right. Like a finger can do what a finger can do, but a hand can do much more than a finger.
Yeah.
So a body of Christ is a corporate connection. Our prayer partners are there. The word also says one sends 1,000 of the enemy to flight and 2, 10,000 to flight.
Oh, right. So I guess
there's exponential power in unified prayer. So that's why we asked you and invite you all the time to call our prayer partners and say, let's stand together in Jesus' name and watch God do something supernatural.
I think we need to mention, what do you mean by send to flight? What are we sending to flight?
The enemy.
Okay.
The enemy.
We're
in our season of turning the tide. When the enemy comes in, like a wave after wave in our lives of different kinds of circumstances that are challenging, negative circumstances, those are what gets sent to flight.
Yes.
You know, that's what the word is dealing with there. The enemy goes to flight, not God, but the enemy. We're going to come back and we're going to talk about this story from World War II and about a Japanese fighter pilot who was there at Pearl Harbor. It has a story that really is quite fascinating. As they say, you can't make these things up.
Okay, I can't wait.
This is a story of real life, real history, and again, his story. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Christy Watts, and thank you so much for watching Cornerstone. We would love to encourage you to join the Harvest Club, where you have the opportunity to give to support the ministry. For just $25 a month, that's less than a dollar a day, you can bring the gospel and love of Jesus Christ to people all around the world. And check this out, when you do that, not only will you be sowing the seeds into people's lives, but we'd also love to bless you. You get a real-life coffee mug, the calendar from Israel, Turning the Tide devotional, an Israel DVD, and even a sister-to-sister pin, all for you. But the greatest gift we can give you is to know that you're winning souls into the kingdom of God. So thank you so much for helping us with hurting people share the gospel of life around the world. Call the number on the screen, 1-888-665-4483. God bless.
You know, Terry and I were just talking at home about our cable bill.
Oh, my goodness.
Don't mention the name of the company.
Okay, we won't.
But our cable bill seems to be going up about every time we get an invoice.
I know. I go, okay, Don, the bill went up. Do you know anything about this? No, I'm going to cancel. So.
Well, I mean, it just seems to be that what can you do with some of these expenses? Like when I go out and fill the car up. You know, think about our $25 a month partner who stands with us and puts that $25 a month in seed into the garden of Cornerstone's ministry. What can you do with $25? I mean, I can't fill the car up with $25.
Oh, no, but you know, your $25 as a Harvest partner, it really helps spread the gospel around the world. Did you know that Cornerstone, we're not only in the Western PA and New York and Ohio, but we're in states across the country, and we're in the countries around the world. We hear from Syria, Cyprus. That's exciting, and your investment with us helps get the word communicated to them, and their lives are changed. Plus, we have Cornerstone Cares, where that's the hands and feet of Cornerstone. And that's an exciting thing too. So we're glad that you're part of us, and we want to invite you, if you're not, to be a Harvest partner.
Yes.
We'd love to have you join with us.
Yeah, we need your partnership. We need you to stand with us strong, because we're in a season that we're pushing forward. We're kind of breaking through some new territory. We're still trying to think what $25. You and I could go to dinner for $25 if we went to someplace like fast food.
I could have 23 and a half unsweet teas at McDonald's. It went up from $1.
Look
at that. I could have that. That wouldn't cover a month, though.
The $25 we're talking about for the ministry goes to eternity.
That's right.
You know, it goes into God's accounting, and He creates your kingdom account. So I just want to say to you, there's a lot you can do with your money. I know there's lots of places you can plug it in. There's lots of great ministries. There's a lot of good people doing good work.
There are.
And we would be quite honored and privileged if you would be a partner with us in telling people about Jesus.
That's right.
and doing it on television and media and all these other ways that we do it, that kind of blows my mind. All the smartphone apps, all the stuff that the Lord has allowed us to do that is cutting edge, reaching into different age groups. So thank you for being a partner if you are. If you're not, we want you to think and pray about becoming a Cornerstone partner, a Harvest partner. Well, again, history, his story. T. Martin Bennett is a writer. He's an entrepreneur. He's from Tennessee. I'm going to get a little interesting story about that in just a second. He's the author of the historical novel. There you see it on your screen, Wounded Tiger. Martin, thank you for coming all the way up.
Thanks for having me.
So glad you're here.
Nice to meet you, Martin.
I think before we get into the story, I like to tell the God story, you know? So you remember Terry and I moved from Franklin, Tennessee 4 years ago.
Right, and you are from?
Well, I currently live in Franklin, Tennessee.
Okay.
Franklin, Tennessee.
I just moved there a month ago.
So one day when I was in Tennessee on my commuting back and forth, Panera Bread was the place I'd hang out from time to time, and I had this chance to inquire. Meeting.
Right, so the book had been released for 1 month. This is the first edition of Wounded Tiger. And I had been living in Tucson, Arizona. A friend invited me to Franklin. I walk into this restaurant, and some guy I don't know walks up to me and says, "You wrote that book, didn't you?" And I said, "What book?" He said, "Wounded Tiger. You wrote Wounded Tiger." And I thought, how in the world am I in this town,
wow,
a complete stranger, and you walked up to me? And I've told that story to many people. And I didn't remember until when I looked up that I was invited to be here, I thought, that's the same guy. This is very interesting. So I'm looking forward to the conversation.
Oh, yeah.
Well, God has ways of putting things together. You know, Martin, the Lord, He directs our paths.
That's right.
And He's directed your path on this journey. This is a long journey.
Long journey.
When did you start?
12 years ago.
With this book?
With this story. So I've always loved history. And I stumbled across this story, a used book from a defunct publisher about the story of the man who led the attack on Pearl Harbor and who came to faith. And I thought, this probably is not a very good story. If it was a good story, I think we'd all know about it. Right. So I started reading information, doing research, and it just hit me. This is an astounding story that needs to be told. I had a tremendous sense of leading of the Lord, say, do it, get it done. And I thought, okay, that's what I'm going to do. So I spent 3 years on research, and the more I dug, it's like digging through dirt. When you hit these little chunks of gold, you're like, wow, this is very interesting. The more I dug, the better the story got. So I wrote the screenplay, had it vetted and critiqued. I ultimately had it in front of some Hollywood people. They wanted to option it, had full funding available, but they wanted full creative control. And sometimes Hollywood gets it right, but sometimes they get it really wrong. And I thought, I just don't want to risk that. Yeah, I want to make some money, but that's not really what drives me. I want to tell the story and tell it right. So I declined the offer. Then I worked on producing the book. So I spent about another year and a half on novelizing this and released it, and it got tremendous reviews. So a quick summary of the story is it's the true story of the pilot who led the attack on Pearl Harbor, whose life was changed by an American prisoner and by a girl he never met. This guy's life story, if it were fiction, wouldn't be any good because it would be too far out to be believed, but it is true.
So let's go back and take apart what you just said. So Wounded Tiger is about a story of a Japanese pilot who led the Pearl Harbor attack.
That's right. He was handpicked by Admiral Yamamoto to lead this attack to destroy the American Navy at Pearl Harbor.
So he was not a believer. He didn't know anything about God.
Not only was he not a believer, he didn't really care. He did not seek God. He was not interested. And that's what's so fascinating about this story. I've had many people critique and read the book, many from a non-religious background. They said they just found it very interesting and very fascinating because eventually it caught up to Fuchida. He should have died on many occasions without giving away the story. He was in Hiroshima. He was stationed there. For the planned engagement with the Allied forces who were planning on invading Japan. He gets a phone call. He gets called away from the meeting. The next day, the atomic bomb is dropped on Hiroshima. All the people in that building were killed. All his friends in this hotel were killed. And he should have died on that occasion. He should have died many times. And it started to slowly add up to him. What is going on? Why am I still here? I think people ask themselves, they might have had a close call in a car accident.
Right.
God, why am I still here? And Fuchida had that question. And God's a rewarder of those who seek him.
That's right.
So that's what happened, without giving away the story. Okay. And it's very interesting what happens. So, yes, Fuchida did seek the Lord, but I think he recognized that God had been seeking him all along.
That's amazing. And then his life was changed by an American prisoner that must have been in a Japanese prison of war camp.
So Fuchida's part of the story is only half of that book. And the book, by the way, has hundreds of photographs. It took me a long time to put together. And there's a guy named Jacob DeShazer, Jake, who was in the American Air Corps. He volunteered on a mission he knew nothing about called the Doolittle Raid. They were the first Americans to attack Japan after the Pearl Harbor attack. This happened in April 18th, 1942. So he ends up becoming a prisoner of war, and he was just filled with anger and hatred toward the Japanese people. In his own words, he was crazy with rage. He just wanted to kill these people. But something happens, which I can't tell you exactly what and how, but he has a complete change of mind, and it transforms him. And then he starts having a love for the Japanese people. Then there's Peggy Covell. She's the daughter of a family of teachers who came to Japan as teachers and as missionaries. They loved the Japanese people. They volunteered to go to the worst parts of town on a regular basis to help people and to give them the good news. Eventually, when Japan was ramping up for war, they fled to the Philippines and they sent their children to the United States. So without giving away the story, Peggy Covell is in upstate New York, thousands of miles away from Fuchida, and her life ultimately has a massive impact on Fuchida's life that turns his whole world upside down.
Wow.
And so the way I like to phrase it is, she grew up with the Japanese children and grew up in Japan. She spoke fluent Japanese, but what do you do when the people you love do the things you hate?
Right.
This was a decision she was faced with, and I think all of us are faced with that at some point or another. In our families, in our workplace, and we say, what do you do when people you love do things you absolutely hate? That's what, and what she did, even to this day, is still astounding to me, and it had a huge impact on Fuchida's life.
That's amazing. I can't, so it sounds like your book not only talks about this history, but you also have some great life principles for all of us
Many
to learn.
Many are in there.
the book is, people many times think of history and they think it's cold and dry, you know, and it's just all about how many battleships were here and how many guns were here. This isn't about that at all.
No, some people, especially female readers who read a lot of books, they say, bombs, planes, ships? I don't think so. I say, well, this is a character-driven story. And I've had this happen many times. I had a woman look me straight in the eye and says, Martin, I'm going to read 4 pages. That's it. I don't like this kind of a story. I said, it's a character-driven story. If you don't like it, that's okay. So I gave her a copy of the book. A few days later, she writes me an email, unbelievable story. I never thought I would read a story like this. But let me tell you about the title.
Sure. Yeah,
okay, so people have asked, you know, Wounded Tiger, why this name? And you've probably heard the term Tora, Tora, Tora from the famous movie, and that was the phrase, the code word for the Japanese Air Command, Fuchida's plane, for him to say back to the fleet, we have achieved complete surprise attack. And that word, Tora, 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 is tiger. Tiger, tiger, tiger. That was the code word. So Wounded Tiger is really Fuchida. He was born in the year of a tiger, and he has, and the nation of Japan was a wounded tiger. They felt sidelined by the rest of the world, marginalized. They were not accepted by the United States. There was tremendous discrimination in California against Japanese, Chinese, and it was really bad. And it's actually, you'll see, when Fuchida found out about it, it really made his blood boil. But Fuchida was a very smart man. He was very aggressive. He had hopes and dreams. So in a sense, really, everyone is a wounded tiger. We all have great potential for beauty and power and greatness. But wounds, either at the hands of other people or maybe our own choices, hold us from reaching our potential. You can't reach that potential until you find healing. Fuchida did find that healing, and you will see it happen before your eyes. And it really gives hope and inspiration to other people that, you know what, I don't care who you are, what your situation is, God actually has a great, great purpose and plan he can fulfill. I don't care where you are. When you read the story, you'll say, you know what, my life's bad. It's not as terrible as this. I haven't killed thousands of people. But if God can do something in his life, maybe he can do something in my life. And the fact is, God is a rewarder of those who seek him.
That's exactly right. So when people you love don't do what you expect for them to do or disappoint you, how did you say that before?
when the people you love do the things you hate?
Yeah.
How do you respond?
Mm-hmm. How do you respond? I think that's the question for our family at home. How do you respond to that? How do you, when you're totally disappointed, maybe in despair, come to a place of despair, how do you turn your life around? Or do you get pulled down in the draft of that, where you start to feel yourself sinking? That's the key. And this work, and I got to congratulate you on the work. I know it's 12 years. That's a long time.
Yeah, well, I wrote the screenplay first, got the book out. It's at the top of the charts as far as, you know, ratings and everything else. And I'm now working on trying to pull together the right financiers on the film side of this deal.
That's why I was going to ask if you were going to try again to do
a
film.
I'm working very hard to get the film done.
Well, this has got a God's fingerprint on it. And only I say that to you with great confidence. And I'll tell you the reason why. Because the Lord put me in the play early on there in Franklin. Because I remember praying with you there at that store.
Yes, and that was really an astounding event, because I thought, how can I walk into a restaurant and within 5 minutes this guy is praying for this project? I thought, this is just very unusual. That's never happened to me anywhere in my life before or since. It's never happened.
That was a Holy Spirit connection. Yeah. And so what I do, and I believe we have a praying family, mm-hmm. we have a praying family that we want to pray. Now, this isn't its third printing?
This is the second edition, so it has an edition of this 270 photos and 10,000 new words.
This is an updated version.
This is updated.
I want to encourage you to get a copy for yourself. Now, you say, I don't care about history. This is about his story.
That's right.
So then go to our website, ctvn.org, and we're going to show you how you can link to get a copy of Wounded Tiger and hear that testimony of how it took. The guy who was the point bomber at Pearl Harbor for the Japanese, and brought his life into a place that he became actually in the ministry. So mm-hmm. I won't tell too much of your story either, because I want you to read the story. But get a copy for yourself and your family. But here's the other thing I want you to do is pray with us that this book will find its proper place in being made into a film.
That's right.
Because that's mm-hmm. the next big step. And I'm confident, Martin, that the Lord's going to do that, because I'm confident he's going to show you the right pathway. Because Hollywood will take it, but you want to make sure it stays true to the message.
That's right.
So let's pray for that now.
And I really feel that there's some of you out there that you've gone through World War II, and Pearl Harbor, you remember, was just like yesterday. And there might be some wounds. You might be a wounded tiger yourself. And the only way that you can reach your potential is to allow Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit to take that wound and heal that wound so that you can become all that God's created you to be. Because that wound is a baggage in your life, and it's not allowing you to reach your potential. So like what Martin shared with this pilot who had to be healed of his wounds, and God used him mightily. I don't know the story, but from what Martin shared, that's what happened. I know that God can do that in your life as well.
So let's pray. Let's pray together. Call us 1-888-665-4483. And for those that are home in our prayer team, would you stretch your hand out towards this set? We're going to pray together, and I'm going to lay my hand on this book, and we're going to pray in Jesus' name. Father, we come to you. We know this is a book that was inspired by you, was drafted by you, Lord. The lives were led by you. And Lord, we know that this book needs to become a movie that can touch millions of people's lives. And Lord, we pray for your right connections for Martin, Lord. Take him to that next place, Lord, so he can find the right people that can put this book together into a film. Give him wisdom and direction and favor. In the name of Jesus, we ask. Amen and amen. Well, thank you. It's good to see you here.
Thank you so much, Don. Thank you so much.
We're so glad to be able to see the circle. Now, you got to come back. I'd like for you to come back and talk about this from a military perspective around the Pearl Harbor. Would be very, very interesting to me. So we'll watch for him to come back and do that. Let's go to Sydney for some good news.
I'm Sydney Grant for Good News 360. Here's how the Holy Spirit is moving around the nation. A Walmart cashier shocked a South Carolina family after hearing the voice of God. Shamanique Desant says the Lord told her to give $100 to a family checking out in her line. Desant says a still small voice prompted her to bless the family. She ended up paying for half of the family's groceries. Desant's random act of kindness has gone viral with more than 5,000 shares. And one man is calling his debilitating disease a gift from God, and his reasons as to why is touching hearts across the country. Roger Florcoy was born with cerebral palsy, but he's not letting that stop him from serving the Lord. Take a look.
God made me who I am, and I was born with cerebral palsy, not because of an accident, but on purpose. When I take a song, purpose, I say, oh man, how can I not worship God because he loves me that much to give me free peace so I can encourage the old body of the church and non-believers.
Flournoy says he loves seeing all kinds of faces at church because it reminds him that the body of Christ is made up of all kinds of people. How wonderful is that? That's all for Good News 360. Have a great day on purpose.
That's amazing.
That is truly amazing. And the first story about the Walmart cashier, she heard God speak to her to help pay for someone's groceries. Mm. I mean, how many times do we think that we might hear God, but we sort of dismiss it and say, oh God, you wouldn't have me do that. But I really feel that God, he wants you to bless other people. Mm. And so in blessing, sometimes he will tell you to do something for somebody, and you got to go through that barrier in your own thinking and to obey what God tells you to do.
Well, it reminds me of Wounded Tiger in some ways, that the unexpected happens.
That's right.
Exactly.
You know, and isn't that the way God always is? The unintended becomes really what becomes the facts. This was an unintended, this was never intended to be.
No. The most common thing I write in the book when I sign them is expect the unexpected. Mm. Right when you think everything's going to zig, then it zags. I find that really interesting, and I also find it very encouraging. So this young lady, Peggy Covell, who really is the fulcrum of this story, even though she doesn't play a lot of parts, she plays a huge part. She never intended to do anything big and great. She was just simply doing the small things in obedience that had an unbelievably massive impact on the lives of others. I think that's true of all of us, and I don't care who you are or what you're doing. She never in a million years would have ever imagined that a college girl in upstate New York would have a huge impact on a guy in Japan. We don't know. Our lives are connected.
Well, let's go back. Let's go to your testimony. Did you intend to be an author?
Well, that's really interesting. The answer is no, I did not. I had teachers when I was in school, in grade school, and wherever, that teachers say, well, Martin, you're an incredible writer. You know, you're going to be famous. And I thought, I don't really want to write. But when I came across stories, actually, the first story I came across that inspired me was the story of John Newton, the guy who wrote Amazing Grace. Yes. So I started researching the story for a film, and I told my wife I'd like someone to write this out as a screenplay. She said, Martin, you'd never be satisfied with somebody else writing it, so you should just write it yourself. And I thought, well, I'm not really a writer. So I read a lot of material. I put the screenplay together. I had some Hollywood professionals read it, and they said, Martin, this is just heads and shoulders over anything we've ever seen. And I thought, why are they saying that? I didn't quite get what they were saying. Mm-hmm. And I told you earlier that I had an option on the Fuchida story. And I said, well, I was going to wait, and I put it into book form. So it's my first book, okay, my first book. And I thought, the reason I wrote it was not to make money or sell books. I thought, well, some people want to watch the movie, some people want to read the book, so right. I'll go ahead and do the book for those people. But once I did the book, I had person after person, and I'm not exaggerating, they said, this is the greatest story I've ever read in my entire life. Multiple people. So the fact is, God has gifts he's given to us. He has a calling. You exercise your gifts in serving others. And I kind of stumbled into realizing I had a gift for writing.
So someone's watching us right now, and they feel like you were before. Somebody's encouraged them somehow, but they haven't exercised that. How do you encourage them?
The way the gifts work, and the way I see them working, is when you look for ways to serve others, you're naturally going to gravitate to what you do best, and then the Lord will fulfill his purposes and plans. So the way I say it is, apple trees produce apples, apple trees don't eat apples. Our gifts aren't for us, they're for other people. So if an apple tree is saying, I don't know what's happening, just forget about yourself, say, how can I serve other people? Have an apple. Your natural gifts will come out, whether you're a servant or a teacher or a helper or whatever your gifts are. So I honestly did not realize how good of a writer I was until I started saying, I got to figure out a way to tell this story and I'll just go ahead and do it. Hmm. And pow, there it was.
That's amazing.
I would encourage you, start serving apples.
That's
start giving out what you got, whatever it is. You say, I don't have anything. Yeah, you do. You've been given gifts. There's something about you. Think back how the Lord has used you in the past. Find another opportunity to do that. Maybe it's to pray for somebody. Maybe it's just to give them an encouraging word. You know, maybe it's to stand with somebody and help them in a practical way, like take them a meal or, I mean, whatever it is. Don't make it spiritual. One of the worst things we do as Christians, Terry, is we make things spiritual.
Right.
Let's make it practical.
I think that God was all into the practical. I mean, he saw people hungry and he fed them fishes and loaves.
Then he told them the truth. Then he told them a story.
Mm-hmm.
You
That's
know,
right.
That'd be like us now, you know, Martin, it'd be like going to the movie theater and they give you the free popcorn and then they let you watch the movie. That's what Jesus did. He gave them the free popcorn and then he told them the story. So that's what we need to do. We need to tell people stories. And then we watch how God supernaturally works in their lives. Mm-hmm. Let's go into prayer room with Amanda. She's right in the middle of it for us.
Well, Don, the phones are ringing off the hook here at Cornerstone Television. I'm so thankful that we have a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week prayer line for you to be able to call so we can agree in prayer with you. And you know what? If you don't know the call that God has in your life, just know that in Ephesians 1, 17 and 18, it tells us to pray that the Lord would enlighten our understanding so that we would know what He has for us to do. And we're here to be that agreement with you on God's word to see you fulfill your call on your life. Well, I just wanted to bring up, you know, we had a veteran give us a call because he has just been struggling with a mental battle clear back from when he served in the Vietnam War. And I think it's not by accident. He called on this day. So, Zach, we are lifting you up in prayer. We're thanking God that He is your sound mind and God is at work in your life. And we also have Judy that called in for a little baby that's in the hospital. There was a deformed part of her body and she is just struggling for her life. So we're going to lift her up and her parents and believe God just being right there, being peace and wholeness in that household. Well, we want you to know you continue to call in. We're going to be taking these prayer requests out and covering them and expecting God to do the impossible in your life. Well, stay tuned for these important messages.
Hello, I'm Jerry Boyer. Come explore with me The Calling.
Hi, I'm Rabbi Daniel Lapin. And I'm delighted to have this opportunity of taking a few moments to share with you something on my heart. Now, it might strike you as odd that an Orthodox Jewish rabbi speaks so warmly and so enthusiastically about the Cornerstone Network, but there's a reason for that. Because I live in the United States of America, and I believe the United States of America is at a critical crossroads that will only be restored, that will only come right by a great rejuvenation and a restoration of fervent Christianity. That's something that Cornerstone Network is contributing to. And I feel privileged each and every time I get the opportunity to appear on Cornerstone Network because the network brings authentic, biblically based teaching. It brings individualized glimpses into people's lives. It exposes the Bible in a way we don't get anywhere else. I'm proud to be a part of that. I support Cornerstone Network. And I would regard it as a personal favor if you do exactly the same.
We've been talking about prayer and the power of prayer. We've been talking about how God surprises us, you know, how we can kind of expect the unexpected when you're walking by faith. Don't put God in a box and say he's always going to do it this way or he's always done it that way. That's not how God works. He wants to be spontaneous with you and me. His love is that kind of relationship where he wants it to be full of sparks, you know, and that's the kind of relationship you want to be in. You don't want to be in a dull, put it in a box and predict the rest of your life. You want it to be spontaneous. Let's look at a scripture that says something about this. It's Psalms, the 34th chapter, the 4th verse says this, I sought the Lord and he heard me and he delivered me from all of my fears. You know, I personally know how fear can be an absolute controller. I've been there. I've been in that place where you're nearly frozen with panic and anxiety. Well, you want to crawl under the rock. Somebody can relate to what I'm saying. Well, you don't want to be out in the daylight. You want to crawl under the rock and just hide. I've been in that place. But, you know, there's times when God wants us to come up out of that because he's nowhere in the Bible does it say that he wants us to be in the dark. We talked about it earlier. God is the God of the light. He wants to turn his light into our lives because he loves us. And here's what I want you to hear me clearly say, and this is what I've discovered in my own life. I'm not alone. You know, Terry's with me, my family's with me, but more importantly, God's with me. God's with you. So what you do when you feel like that, you feel that fear and that anxiety and that crawl out and get under the rock kind of mentality, cry out to him. Start looking and listening for his voice. Because when you listen for God, you know, you got to listen. Like I said a little while ago, get in a quiet place. Listen for his voice. And when you do, he'll lead you into the freedom that he's designed you to live in. The Bible says this, guys. He said, who the Son has set free is free indeed. Free indeed. There's meaning in those words. Those aren't just words. Those free indeed means that across all parameters, every area of our lives, we can have freedom. We don't have to walk under the bondage of fear, whether it's in our finances, whether it's in our families, whether it's in our health. No area. God will set us free indeed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. It's a good word. I know I heard fear is false evidence appearing real. So it's those things you've said it before, like we sit and we mull over things and what, 90 some percent of it never even comes to pass. We didn't even need to be putting our thoughts on that and we just got to focus in on God's word. But you know, so many of our callers that called in, they're walking through it because what happens when you hear that report? I mean, we've got to hone in on what the Lord says, what his report is, you know, of our health. Mm-hmm. Or the situation with that praise report is amazing. I'm just like,
well,
but
hey, read it to
delivering
us.
From fear.
Hey, read us the praise report.
Oh, okay. Sister Jean, is that right? Mm-hmm. And that the problem was no child support.
Right.
And that God moved and the results were fantastic and there's victory.
Yeah, God
that's
moved
awesome.
On the father's heart because she was not getting. And we know so many individuals going through this and the fear of not having enough when you have children and, you know, you're just beseeching God, but he came through and changing the heart of their father. So it was an amazing story of hope.
Well, and that God is faithful, isn't it? When we least expect it and to the unexpected, like who would have thought that a Japanese soldier would have come to know Christ, you know, that
and become,
was,
and become a minister.
And become a minister. Well, I don't know that part of the story, so I mean, I can't say
that. He was probably among the most unlikely of people to ever, one, become a Christian, and two, spend the rest of his life preaching the good news around the globe. I mean, that's what he did. And very few people know the story, but yeah, it's unpredictable and the unexpected. This is what God does.
Mm-hmm. Well, God's the God, we like to say around here, of the suddenly. What looks dark suddenly becomes light.
That's right.
Because if we turned all the lights off in the studio, you wouldn't be able to see us. But when you flip the switch on, immediately everything's illuminated. That's how God works.
Well, do you think then maybe that we should take the attitude that we need to expect the suddenly in God.
And the unexpected.
I mean, rather than just take the mediocre or the routine. Excuse me, tongue-tied there, of everyday living, that we just go and we just go into our day saying, God, I want to have the suddenlies. I want to have the unexpected. And Lord, I don't want this day to be an average day. And it could be that your neighbor needs that add a girl or add a boy kind of thing, but we need to just be part of the suddenly too, right?
Amen.
Just be sensitive, guys, gals and guys. I get called out one time for saying the word guys. Now you're a wordsmith person, so you know, you kind of...
It can be generic for girls call each other guys sometimes.
That's
right. Hey, guys.
Uh-huh.
Well, I want to...
Pittsburgh, you say yins.
Yins. yins guys.
Or if you're
yins
from
guys.
The South, you say y'all. Hey, right. Y'all.
Y'all, listen to me. Let's pray. It's time for us to join our faith together. Amen. So if you'll just stretch your hearts out with us.
Yes,
and if you're on our Real Life prayer team, stretch your hands towards the camera too, because we need your prayers too in unity for this. Lord, we pray for every one of these precious ones. Lord, for Zach and for Sister Jean and for every one of these people, Lord, who you've touched their lives in a way, Father, that they know you and they have faith to call, Father. So we pray, Lord, that you will touch their hearts in a supernatural wave of grace and mercy. That the love that you have for them will just be manifest in their lives. Lord, you cover their hearts with that blanket of love. Lord, and whatever their needs are, Father, that they'll submit those needs to you, Lord. We put our hearts together with them, and we thank you that you're our God. You are our provider. You are our Father. Lord, you are our healer. Father, you are our deliverer. Lord, that you are the one who made us, who takes us where we are, and will put us where we need to be by the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord. We thank you for these lives, Lord. Stir up the gifts of the Holy Spirit in them. And we ask, Lord, for great testimonies to come in Jesus' name, of your power, your love, and your grace. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, thank you, brother, for coming, sharing about your work. Come back, talk to us about Pearl Harbor and when the book turns into a movie, which we're expecting. Amanda, thank you.
It's been awesome.
Sherry,
answered
thank
prayer.
You. And thank you for being our partners. Thank you for helping us. Stand with us in Jesus' name to take the gospel to more and more people every day on Real Life. We'll see you tomorrow.
Do you feel lonely, forgotten, afraid? You are never alone. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them. For the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Who is our God? Father to the fatherless, defender of widows. This is God whose dwelling is holy. God places the lonely in families. He sets the prisoners free and gives them joy. Know that your life has a purpose. You have meaning, and you aren't around by accident. I have called you back from the ends of the earth so you can serve me, for I have chosen you and will not throw you away. Don't be afraid, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand. If you ever feel alone, call our prayer lines. We are always here for you. Know that Jesus is with you wherever you are, and you are loved.
Cornerstone Television wishes to thank all our faithful viewers whose consistent prayers and financial support have made this program possible.